baby hair with a woman's eyes. I can feel you watching in the night. All alone with me, we're waiting for the sunlight. When I feel cold,
the lyrics were written by me, Charlie Hannon, and the music was written by Alexander Biglin. Walked down this road once, twice, 100 times before, And if I can say anything, it opens up my eyes. We've gone so far, chasing things that are but dreams. And yet for every misstep we take, for every fall we make, we rise, we rise. We've walked off worse than this before. We've made it this far, we can do more. We can rise, we can rise. It's not the fall that breaks us, it's staying down on the floor. And it's not the heights that make us, it's rising up to be more. So for every fall, get back up. With every single step, rise on up. We can rise, we can rise. So for every fall, get on up and rise. Oh, we can rise. Rise above the anger and the failure and the spite. And let's all just be grateful that we all still got life. Despite all the wars, people still fight, we still got life. And so though it cannot be rationalized, we still rise, we still rise. And so walk down this road once, twice, 100 times before. And if I can say anything, it opens up my eyes. We always rise, we rise.
It was about 2 weeks ago. I was walking down the street one afternoon, and I turned up the stairs into my flat, and I looked back, and he was there, framed in the doorway, looking up at me. I couldn't see his face, because the light came in from behind him, and he was in shadow. And he said, "I am Picasso." And I said, "Well, so what?" And he said he wasn't sure yet, but he thinks it means something in the future to be Picasso. He said that occasionally there is a Picasso, and he happens to be him. He said the 20th century has to start somewhere, and why not now? Then he said, "May I approach you?" And I said, "Okay." He walked upstairs and picked up my wrist and turned it over and took his fingernail and scratched deeply on the back of my hand. In a second, in red, the image of a dove appeared. Then I thought, why is it that someone who wants me can hang around for months, and I even like him, but I'm not going to sleep with him, but someone else says the right thing and I'm on my back, not knowing what hit me? See, men are always talking about their things, like it's not them, it's someone else. And it's true, it's like some rudderless fireworks snaking across town. But women have things too. They just work differently. They work from up here. So when the guy comes on to me through here, he's practically there already, done. So the next thing I know, he's inside the apartment, and I said, "What do you want?" And he said he wanted my hair, he wanted my neck, my knees, my feet. He wanted his eyes on my eyes, his chest on my chest. He wanted the chairs in the room, the notepaper on the table, the paint from the walls. He wanted to consume me until there was nothing left. He said he wanted deliverance and that I would be his savior. And he was speaking Spanish, which didn't hurt, I'll tell you. Well, at that point, the word no became like a Polish village. Unpronounceable. I held out for seconds. Frankly, I didn't enjoy it too much, because it was kinda quick.
You know, Mom, you keep asking me that question, my answer never changes. My day was fine. Nothing happened, good or bad. All I did was go to class. Everything's so different, you know? Like, look outside. There's so many trees, and the roads are all bendy and twisty and bumpy. There's so many hills, they have to build the houses in a specific way so that they don't fall down. And there's no Publix. I mean, what the heck kind of name is Giant Eagle for a grocery store? Hold on, let me get back to my point. I guess those are all things I can get used to. After a while, they won't seem so weird. What'll stay weird, though, are people. They do different things. They eat different food. They find different things funny. The weirdest thing is, they all lived a life before they even knew I existed. They grew up together without me. They had fun without me. They laughed without me. They bonded without me. Then all of a sudden, one day I show up and I gotta figure out what the deal is. I have to, integrate. And even worse, my old friends are doing the same now. They're having fun without me. They're laughing without me. They're making memories without me. They're perfectly content without me. Meanwhile, I've got nothing to do. My phone's dead silent, no text or anything. I don't know many people, and I don't have anybody to talk to outside of school. My old friends text me less and less, and I'm too scared to text them because I've got nothing interesting to say. I scroll through my text conversations and stare at the dates of when I last texted these people, the ones who I'd spend every day with. My phone reminded me of David's birthday last week, and I got all excited to text him happy birthday. And then when I scrolled through the conversation, I realized that the last time we spoke was months ago. My closest friendship has been relegated to a happy birthday text. There are a lot of things I miss. I miss our old house. I miss our old street. Our old neighborhood. My old school. My old friends. I've been reliving memories in my head over and over for months. With family members near me to celebrate holidays with, friends I grew up with, and people I could talk to for hours. Parties, school events, sleepovers, even classes. My thoughts are trapped in a world that only exists in my memories. You seem to have it all figured out. Wait, hold on, I know, let me finish. Like, you're already friends with all the neighbors. You know where all the stores are. You're used to the streets. You're so present. Like you moved on. There's no way that was easy, right? I guess I should do the same, huh? If I don't stop thinking about what I'm missing and start focusing on what's actually happening, and instead of making myself feel better, I'll just lose the opportunity to make new memories. That sounds really hard. But maybe you could help me since it was so easy for you. I had a fine day today. But soon I want to be able to say that I had a great one. I think I'll get there eventually. And who knows? Maybe that day isn't so far away.
All right, I admit, I stole this from you, right before we got on the cruise. I'm not trying to steal everything right now. I'm changed. I am. It's just that sometimes I feel, like, a little depressed. And I think to myself, maybe I would feel a little bit better if I had your watch. Look, we're all having a bit of a hard time right now with this quarantine, so just leave me my little vices. Really. You don't need that coat, or that leather handbag. You're not going anywhere. My wardrobe has doubled in size. When we were still going out, you could see people about to say something when they see me in their clothes, and then they don't. Don't want to get too close, maybe. Or maybe they don't need as much as I need it. And I was doing so well, too. I was calm. I was not stealing things. I had a program. And I was sticking to it, too. And then, well, you know, Life likes to throw curveballs, and I was never good at baseball. I stole home once, they asked for it back. Sorry, bad joke. Look, we all want stuff, like, lots of stuff. And yeah, overall in bulk it won't make me feel any better, really. But also, it makes you feel a little good, at first. That's the problem, isn't it? Because I hate myself for taking it. But also, look at that. That's pretty. And tomorrow, I won't like it as much as today, maybe, but I can find something else pretty. Look at you. You bet all kinds of things, didn't you? Just don't look away too long, okay? Because I'm going to take some of those things. Don't say I didn't warn you. Oh, look how scared you look. Relax. You don't need any of those things. I do. I need it all. All of it.
I'm nervous and upset because this girl I've never met, I get to meet tonight at 8. I'm taking her to dinner at a charming old cafe, but who can eat tonight at 8? It's early in the morning and our date is not till 8 o'clock tonight, and yet already I can see what a nightmare this whole day will be. I haven't slept a wink, I only think of our approaching tete-a-tete tonight at 8. I feel a combination of depression and elation. What a state to wait till 8. 3 more minutes, 2 more seconds, 10 more hours to go. In spite of what I've written, she may not be very smitten, and my hopes perhaps may all collapse kaput tonight at 8. I wish I knew exactly how I'll act and what will happen when we dine tonight at 8. I know I'll drop the silverware, but will I spill the water or the wine tonight at 8? Tonight I'll walk right up and sit right down beside the smartest girl in town, and then it's anybody's guess. More and more I'm breathing less and less. In my imagination I can hear our conversation taking shape tonight at 8. I'll sit there saying absolutely nothing, or I'll jabber like an ape tonight at 8. 3 more minutes, 2 more seconds, 10 more hours to go. I'll know when this is done, if something's ended or begun, and if it goes all right, who knows, I might propose tonight at 8.
Why aren't you with the rest of the guys?
Same reason as you, I gotta think. Just want some peace and quiet.
What's the score?
Got eyes?
God, they're still down one?
Yep. What's the scenario again?
Home loses, we get eliminated. Home wins, we go to the playoffs. You know that, though.
Yeah. Just wanted to make sure it was real.
You ever been in a situation like this?
Never.
Really, you've been around a while.
You calling me old?
No. Experienced.
Mm.
Veteran.
Yeah. Synonyms for old. You're right, though. I'm old. Gotta admit that to myself. Good thing this is the end.
You should,
No. Not discussing this.
Let me finish. You should reconsider if we make it, or if we don't.
So regardless, in your little dream scenario, I stay?
Yeah.
It's not happening, kid.
Don't.
Don't what? Don't call you kid? Don't admit that I'm leaving you? Leaving the team? Don't admit that you're gonna be on your own next year?
I don't know, man. Just don't.
Okay.
Tell me what it was like again. Your first playoffs?
Awful. You know that, though.
Yeah, but like you said, just wanted to make sure it was real. Kind of crazy.
What? That my career is going to be ended by the same team that crushed my dreams as a 20-year-old?
Don't talk like that.
Okay, that my career could be ended by the same team that crushed my dreams as a 20-year-old?
Yeah. I remember hearing about that series from my dad. It made him so mad. Even now I remember that I came downstairs for breakfast so excited, and he was just crushed. Can't imagine what it was like. I just remember hearing about it.
I mean, you probably know it better than I do. Tell me what went wrong.
Come on, don't. Not now.
Yes, now. You know this helps.
Fine. Anemic offense for us. Bad starting pitching for us. Their starting pitching was way too good. Too many pass balls and borderline pitches going in their favor. You hit .297 all season, led the league in OBP, won Rookie of the Year. Then you didn't get a hit in 3 games. You sucked so much, you got benched in the 7th of game 3.
So I think you know what it was like.
No, I don't. I wasn't there. I was 4 years old. I only know what happened from talking about it with my dad and reading about it and watching throwback re-airings. You always give me some clinical answer or ask me about the stat sheet. But what was it like?
I wanted to quit. Really. I wanted to leave baseball. I got drafted 2 years earlier, and I wanted to leave the league, go to college. But then when we got back to the hotel, my girlfriend called me, and she told me I was stupid. No, really. She said, "I think you're the stupidest person I've ever met. If you leave baseball just because of some piece of garbage series when you were 20. She said that if she let me quit, those were her words, that she would never forgive herself because I would regret it, and she loved me so much that she would regret it too. She told me she loved me for the first time that night. It stopped me from abandoning my first love."
Ever tell her baseball beats her?
First love, not best. After all these years, she is it for me. Baseball can't measure up.
Think I'll be okay if we do make it?
No. Well, I think you'll be more than okay. Son, you're a better ball player than anyone in this clubhouse. If we make it, you'll be the reason we did. And you'll be the reason we go as far as we do. Cuticle trouble?
No. What about the World Series? You know, 5 years ago.
No. We're not talking about that. You know that's off limits. We're not talking about that. Especially tonight. Don't get all that in your head.
Okay. What are you gonna do if we don't make it?
You mean, what am I gonna do if my lifelong dream ends because of some 2-bit team I'm watching on the television?
Yeah. Well, if we don't make it, I'm going camping. Never been camping. And I wanna go fishing. Not on some ocean, on a quiet little river where I can catch trout and release them. I wanna make coffee over a campfire and listen to the stars.
Listen to the stars?
Yeah, I think there's music in the stars.
You got some funny ideas about the country, man. Well, okay, yeah. If we don't make it, I'm gonna buy my kids one of those wooden play sets. And I'm gonna build it. All by myself, not gonna ask for any help. Well, I'm no handyman. My wife learned plumbing and auto repair and all that. Yeah, but I'm gonna build our kids something. And I'm gonna read to them every night.
Don't think the 12-year-old's gonna like that.
Like he's got a choice. He's being read to. You got a tent?
What?
A tent for camping. Do you already have a tent?
Yeah.
Then I'm going camping with you. Gonna catch some trout just to let them go. Gonna drink some awful coffee. I'm gonna listen to the stars.
What are you gonna do when spring comes?
I don't know. It's my first spring without spring training since I was 18. I was a senior, just thinking about whether I was gonna get drafted or gonna go to college. That was all so long ago now, it's hard to think about. So yeah, I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know? How can you not know? Aren't you gonna come back and coach?
Where'd you get that idea in your head?
I don't know, isn't that what old guys do when they retire?
Hey!
No, that's what old guys do when they retire. They don't just leave the team that's given them everything and the guys that love them. They come back and help because they owe it to the team.
Hey!
No, you don't just leave me here alone. You can't do that to me. You taught me everything and you can't leave me. You can't leave me just because some other team can't win. You don't get to leave me like that.
Hey! You remember that first series? The pitcher who started the game? Same number of years between me and you and him and me. He was 36. I got called up right around when you got called up. Road trip, late April. Didn't know anyone. But this guy comes up to me and tells me it's his start day. My first game, he's throwing to me. I say, okay. He tells me he's gonna be looking out for me. It means something that he's the first guy I'm catching. Yeah, it means something. That playoff series, he got pulled in the fifth. Double switch or triple switch or something. He got pulled because of me. His career ended because I had a cold bat. After the game, he was packing up his bag for the last time. And I had the gall to go up to him and ask him when we should plan to get lunch. Because, of course, he was coming back as a coach for spring training. He told me some stories just don't end like that. He was gonna spend time with his family. No more baseball. So I got real mad at him, cursing him out in front of everyone. But calm as can be, he takes me out to the hallway and tells me that if I get the career I deserve, I'm gonna be hearing it from some little 20-something who's too scared to know what he needs, to know that he's good enough on his own. You're a kid, you're good enough. You don't need me. And one day you're gonna be hearing it from some kid. And I don't say if you get the career you deserve, because you're going to. You love this game more than the air you breathe. And you're terrified because you know the future is on your shoulders. But you're strong. You just don't need me. Me? I'll just be some memory of the old guy you used to know. Just like that pitcher. And one day, it'll be the last day we see each other. And we're not gonna know it. But you're gonna be fine. And me, I'll be Ah, you need ice? Yeah, kid, if you would.
Here.
Thanks. Two outs.
Yep. You know, I don't really care if we make it or not.
No?
No, it doesn't matter in the end. I got some years ahead of me, and that first series didn't matter much to you in the long run. I'm still gonna be annoying you, calling you every day. You're not moving somewhere stupid, right? Like back to your hometown?
Don't call my hometown stupid.
You didn't answer my question.
No, I'm staying here. No, the kids only know here.
Okay, then I'm coming over for dinner every night. You better be making a lot of spaghetti.
With meatballs? Like the ones you threw in your third start?
Shut up. You're scared, right?
Be stupid not to be. But with having to watch this to see if it's the end? Hey, what the hell, man? I want to see what happens!
No. No, we'll find out from the team. I just want to sit here with you. In case this is it.
Okay, Katie, thanks so much for being with us today for a Playwright interview.
Thank you for having me.
No problem. We're so glad that you wrote this great two-hander called Battery. And I'd love to start by just asking you my first opening question, which is, have you ever written a play before?
I actually haven't. I've written some prose before and I write for the newspaper, but I had never written a play before. So it was a very different experience.
Definitely. Okay, great. Well, what was the hardest part about writing a play or this play?
Well, I enjoy writing dialogue, but I think a lot of what I write can be pretty sparse in terms of dialogue. So I'll use everything else to help the reader learn about how I want to set the scene. So when I was writing my first draft, I left a lot of notes that I found very helpful to help set the scene, but for the actors or for the audience, they would help not at all. So my hardest part was definitely like cutting things that I found very important. And having to kind of paste them back in as dialogue. So in terms of dialogue, most of the dialogue has stayed the same since my first draft, but the script looks very different because I've cut a lot of notes.
Right. That makes sense. Okay, and what about the hardest part? I just asked you, sorry. The most positive and rewarding part about writing the play?
I think the most positive part for me wasn't actually anything about writing it, but it was seeing it performed by Jake and Ben for the first time, because I came into it, they're really just great people, but I came into it thinking that they were going to hate it and I was going to hear them hate it and I was going to hate it myself. But then when they really seemed to like performing it, I loved it. And every time I saw them read it, I just went like, this is one of my favorite things that I've ever written. And so I don't like sharing my writing a lot. Like I'll turn something into a teacher and that'll be it. I won't look at it again. But with this, like I kept going back to look at what I had written every time that they performed it, because I just like, I would go back and find something that I hadn't remembered that I really liked. And so I think that just hearing them seem to really enjoy performing it made me really love it.
Definitely. It's a great moment for a playwright to hear their work come alive by two such strong actors. Definitely. Absolutely. And what inspired you to actually write this play?
Well, I'm a really big fan of baseball. And I think it's probably the sport that can lend itself most easily to stories. And I think specifically a pitcher and a catcher, because it's a team sport, but they're like the dynamic duo. They have to be like so connected, and usually they're standing 60 feet, 6 inches apart. So I thought, like, what if I put them somewhere that wasn't so far apart and was not during a game? The inspiration for having them be watching another team's playoff game came from in 2011. There were four teams that were all competing for two playoff spots. So teams ended up watching other teams' games. And I think it was the Cardinals who, there are pictures of them watching other teams' games just in the dugout, you know, or not the dugout, in the clubhouse, just wearing athletic shirts and t-shirts. And like, they've worked their whole lives for this, but right then they look like they're just kind of like us. And I think like forcing like these professional athletes to have no control over it was definitely like kind of like a fun writing experiment.
Definitely. Yeah, it's a whole different experience to picture them in that setting as compared to on the mound and at the pitcher stands or the counter mm-hmm. stands, right? Well, great. And just final thoughts. Any final thoughts just about the experience or writing a play or anything that pops into your mind as a final thought?
Well, I think that not having the musical be in the winter was definitely a change of what we were all expecting. Because for me, for the past 3 years, like doing the musical and having tech week and the performance has been so much of my winter. So it was definitely hard to lose that this year, but to have a completely different experience, it was actually really rewarding and I didn't expect that. And so I really loved writing it. And I think that's a little silver lining that I didn't expect and I was really happy for it.
Yeah, you may not have done that if it happened to have landed in the spring.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, I just want to say, Katie, like I told you when I very first read this script, the very first day, you saw me read it and be moved to tears in the very first draft. And it's just so moving to me in such a unique way. That I'm just really, really amazed by your work. And it's a side of you that I didn't know existed. And I'm so glad that it flourished and that our community was able to experience it. So thank you so much for writing it and for working with me to rewrite and revise, which is hard, but rewarding, hopefully. And we get to see the final product by two amazing actors. So thanks so much for putting in the time.
Well, thank you, Ms. HB, for all of your help with it. It was such a great experience.
Awesome. Thanks, Katie.
Thank you.